Nisargadatta Maharaj, very, very, very nice guru. However, he said that external gurus are only mileposts. Okay. The inner guru is the real guru. The inner guru is the real guru. When he says you cannot take the external guru with you, the inner guru is always with you. Now, you can call the inner guru anything you want. I call it the Holy Spirit. But there is this source within us that we can turn to and ask for answers. Now, it may have seemed in some of the recent videos that I'm getting into something else. No, I'm providing a context for the importance of the urgency and the focus on the effort that is necessary at this time. Because we are going into a time which is very deceptive. And this is what the Bible has told us. Scripture has said, and the end times will be so deceptive, the adversary will be so deceptive, that virtually everybody will be tricked. And this is absolutely so right now. And it's going to peak very soon. So with that in mind, what I do is I ask the inner guru, and it answers. But one has to be very attentive, very determined, and turn to that inner guru and say, what do you suggest? And listen and apply what it says. All day today, I've been doing this. I'm in this most intense effort right now. It is the most intensity ever. And I'm asking the inner guru what to do. What's the answer? And it's working with me, saying, come on. Keep pushing, go faster. Now, so in the mood of repentance, which is all important, which is to say, I acknowledge I have a very severe continuity problem. In that mood, we're supportive of one another and suggesting turn within and ask of the inner teacher, the Holy Spirit, the inner guru, what do you suggest? What's the answer for me? What's your suggestion? And I do this all day. Now, just like we're not going to take an aspirin if we don't realize we have a headache, we're not going to apply what the inner teacher, Holy Spirit, tells us unless we understand what our problem is. And if we admit that we have a severe problem, a most severe problem, in fact, it's the only real problem we have, and it's so severe, it deserves all our attention. This is what I say to the world. Is we all have a problem that is so severe it deserves all our attention. So don't ask me about what do you think about this social cause or this thing or that, these problems. No. I have repented and I have accepted the fact I have this incredibly severe problem which overshadows everything else, and in fact it's actually the only problem there is, because if it weren't for this problem I wouldn't have any problems. There wouldn't be any problems for sure. So it deserves all our attention. This is my point. This problem deserves all our attention. And the other problems do not deserve all our attention. They do not. They're not in the mood of repentance. Though all these various issues that are going on in the world seem so important to people, and they're fanatic about it. And yet they're not repentant, are they? They are not repentant. You never hear one time ever on the television, in the newspaper, on the news, on the internet, anywhere, do you hear anything of someone starting out and saying, I embrace and accept the fact that I have an incredibly severe problem. It's the continuity problem. I have an incredibly severe problem. It's the only problem I have. See, that sets the mood, it sets the tone. All important. Now, in Catholic Mass, they do start out saying, I am a sinner, I've sinned, I've fallen short. So there's some acknowledgement of that. But it's too watered down. It's like a vestige of something, okay? We have to say, I have this incredibly severe problem. I have a severe continuity problem. Therefore, all my attention has to be on this. One moment, please. Okay. This has to be our focus. Otherwise, we're going to miss the boat for sure. For sure. Because only when we realize that we have this incredibly severe continuity problem, which we most certainly do, will we understand the remedy that fixes this problem. Otherwise, the remedy won't make any sense to anybody. They say, nutty, what are you talking about? Sounds nice, but what relevance is that to me? It's like that. So the world seems to be going in a real spiritual direction. It's not. The real spiritual direction is to admit, to accept the fact that you have an incredibly severe continuity problem. Why? Because the light has been incredibly stupid, pretending to be incredibly stupid. And the stupidity, it's very important to recognize, it's not us that has been stupid, actually. We're not incredibly stupid. We're intrigued by the incredible stupidity of light, the apparent incredible stupidity of light. And we're caught between, we don't want to recognize the light has been completely stupid because then we'll be afraid, right? But neither do we want to recognize that the light has not been stupid at all, because then we'll feel we need to drop everything. It's all bogus completely right now. So we're stuck between this this dichotomy, because the light has been pretending to be incredibly stupid. Now, how is that possible? Well, our sensory perception and bodies. Okay, this is the problem, actually. Sensory perception is the problem. And again, don't blame sensory perception, but imagine if you had a camera and you look through the camera viewfinder. And that's all you ever did. And then you drew a conclusion about the world simply through that, camera viewfinder about it, the true nature and dimension of the world. You'd get a limited perspective, wouldn't you? The body is like that. The sensory perception is like that. It leads to a false conclusion. It doesn't force a false conclusion on us at all, but it certainly suggests it. Now, who made these bodies? Light. Light made these bodies. Why did light make these bodies? To provide a means that we could, to provide a means where a false conclusion could be suggested. All right. We asked the light to do this for us, so it did it for us, because it's our servant. Okay, light is our servant. Light is the servant of spiritual will. And so light has done this for us, and we're paying attention to sensory perception. Okay, is extremely misleading, and yet we're extremely intrigued and used to it. Actually, the witness that is used to sensory perception is also part of the light's deception, and it's drawing conclusions from it's what's called the false self. There is no actual self there, but there's a tension that's believing everything sensory perception is suggesting. And what is sensory perception suggesting to us that is so erroneous? Okay, this is the key element here. It's suggesting a certain limited spaciousness to everything. a personal spaciousness to everything. Okay. Sensory perception, when it looks at anything, look at this can, it seems there's a bit of space around this can, right? And there's a wall over, there's a wall here. So the space of this can stops with this wall, right? If you look at anything at all, your sensory perception, you see a certain amount of space around whatever you're looking at. There's a cat over there. Okay, the space the cat's in is just, you know, it's walking along. That's its space. Everything seems to have what's called a personal space to it. The tree is there, and you see some space around the tree, and that's it. That's it. That's what your perception is showing you. Sensory perception is showing you limited spaciousness that we call personal spaciousness. We call it our personal self, our personal space. We think the body has this, you know, amount of personal space around it, that it stops with this wall and this wall. And so now, what the inner guru, Holy Spirit, suggested to me is, because of the continuity fear that we have about not wanting to see the light, not wanting to think the light's completely stupid, nor that it's not stupid at all. Those two extremes are too much for us. So we need an intermediate step to back off of this whole nonsense, actually. We're trying to be greater than God, to separate all this nonsense. But here is the intermediate step that was suggested to me. It's very simple, and it's actually happened to me twice where I made this shift into vision of oneness, actually. And it's actually very, very simple. So let's talk about what this is. It's not changing anything. It's simply recognizing what's already the case, what's already here. It's not changing anything. It's not changing any form. It's not getting rid of sensory perception. It is merely not emphasizing the spaciousness that sensory perception is showing you. It's not denying that this is the limits of sensory perception. It's merely not giving primary emphasis to the conclusion that this is the spaciousness of this object. Okay, it's got a certain amount of spaciousness to it around it. Stops with that tree, that shrub, that concrete, this dirt. You know, but we still function as far as structurally that way. We understand functionally that's fine. We're not attacking anything. We're only saying that in actually everything has infinite spaciousness. Everything is in infinite spaciousness. Now, isn't that actually already the case? It's just our sensory perception does not infer that at all, does it? The fact is, as we're sitting here, that in all directions, up, down, around, all directions, space continues virtually infinitely, if we talk about universe. And ultimately, we don't need to try and go beyond the universe at this point. That's plenty. That's plenty for us. Okay, we're only trying to get this expanded sense of spaciousness, that everything is actually right now, as it is, has this infinite space. It's in infinite space. Everything equally is in infinite space right now. That's actually a fact, without us having to do anything about it. It's merely, we need to accept this fact. And having done so a couple times, the effect was quite extraordinary. And I'm trying to get back to that. We all are. This is what the vision of oneness, the vision of, is a feeling that everything has equal space. Everything has equal space. Everything has infinite space. Infinite space is the one shared quality all things have. There is this one shared quality that all things have, and that is they are literally surrounded, part of infinite space. Infinite space. Everything is that way. It doesn't matter how big it is. This world, all directions, it is surrounded by infinite space, isn't it? A dust particle. In all directions, it is surrounded by infinite space, actually. It's in infinite space. Everything is within, is in infinite space. There's no difference. A rock, a flower, a person, a sun. The sun is in infinite space. So again, there's nothing we actually have to do to make this true. It's already a fact. It's already a fact. This is called going to the impersonal, so to speak, because you go from personal space to impersonal space, is what's happening. It's just a little shift of what's already true. What are you emphasizing? Are you emphasizing personal space or impersonal space, actually? Impersonal space means the space that surrounds me is infinite. It is not limited to just this area around a body. So, I'm going at it very carefully, slowly, laying the groundwork here. There's no question that once we see this infinite space, spaciousness around everything, this brings about incredible happiness and relief, actually. But right now, I'm not experiencing that because I'm not shifted yet, but I'm laying the groundwork here to explain it. Asking the inner teacher to give us these stepping stones to this, because our continuity fear is very shaky about this, but it's calming down, it's calming down, it's calming down. There's this, recently there were these really heavy logs that we had, and too heavy to lift, and so we cut them up with a chainsaw into smaller logs and able to lift them. Still heavy, but you can lift it. So sometimes you need to break it down into little smaller steps, so it's not some huge leap, so it's not too heavy. So that's why we're doing this. So if we at least get comfortable with this, the theory, recognizing the problem we have, we don't want to make a definite assessment about the light at this point, okay? We don't want to draw either conclusion, either totally stupid or I was completely faking everything. And we assume it was faking everything, but we don't want to know this instantly, okay? We don't want to know this was all just a total fabrication, a mirage, an illusion. Not yet. But also, we don't want to be stuck in feeling that, you know, that we're supposed to keep our attention in this narrow personal space, that there's a limited space. We have this intermediate step here, where we do not have to make an ultimate conclusion yet. About the light. Okay, so I'm going to refocus here, just one moment. Now the feeling that we have as a person has to do with the amount of space, sense of spaciousness, actually. We're not aware of that. Personality is defined by restrictions. What it cannot do, where the space ends, where it begins, where it ends in every situation. When we go to some place like it's very spacious, and we look out and there's just nothing obstructing us. We feel differently, don't we? We want to just sit there and say, wow, I feel different. People go hiking, backpacking, various places that they can look out upon the vistas and spaciousness. And there's so much space, everything has so much space. It's just like, and it's very super clear. I like the desert, everything's super clear, super spacious. And you just, you feel like, wow, this is more like me. I feel more like myself. Right? However, what we're talking about is different. It's very different. That's as far as the world goes. Like, here, let's manipulate our space in going places and having nice places, vacations, etc., etc. We're not talking about that. What we're talking about is realizing everything is in infinite spaciousness. Everything has infinite spaciousness right now, always. It doesn't matter where it travels. It doesn't, motion makes no difference to this, does it? Does it? It doesn't make any difference. You know, you move this can around, isn't it still surrounded by infinite spaciousness? So motion doesn't matter. They call it nirvana, not moving. In other words, the sense of spaciousness doesn't move as objects move in it. You're still aware that the infinite spaciousness is not being changed by any action. The action doesn't change it in the slightest bit. And what happens is from this sense of everything has infinite spaciousness, then we really feel like ourselves. We say, wow, This is really what I want to feel. This is what I really want to feel. There's no question about that. Having, again, experienced it just a little bit, I said, hey, this is what we really, truly want. Now, there may be those who say, well, sure, but, you know, we have better teaching, greater teaching, even drop that, blah, 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 blah. Fine, if they want to be greater teachers, let them be great teachers or whatever. Doesn't matter. Just see infinite spaciousness around them too. Okay? Don't let anyone say, well, I'm some greater teacher, and therefore, here's how I want you to see me. No. Or here's how I want you to see things. No. See infinite, be aware of infinite spaciousness, not perceptually. Obviously, you can't see infinite spaciousness perceptually. Sense, be aware with the eye of the mind, eye of spirit, that there's infinite spaciousness. It's a presence. You feel it. It's a felt presence around everything. Everything shares this. Everything shares this common quality. This common, and it's the most important quality of all. And we haven't explained why, because that I have not yet asked for exactly the answer yet to that. I'm just laying this out first. Now, certainly, the way the world's going is to say, hey, we can make our personal space more beautiful. In fact, I'm so beautiful, my personal space is really beautiful, and that's all you need. Compare that though to seeing, to being aware and feeling infinite spaciousness with everything without exception, and you can tell right away there's a dramatic difference right between the two ways we're talking. The world's going one direction, we're going in the other direction. World is going to our more and more beautiful cars, beautiful bodies, beautiful dresses, beautiful clothing, beautiful ornamentation, beautiful homes, beautiful landscape, beautiful vacations, beautiful things, etc., 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 right? And they're saying keep your sensory perception on all this, because the more beautiful it is, the more beautiful the little space you see is going to be. Okay, compare that life, which is what the world is telling you, this is your life, this is your future life, this is what's going to make you happy. Compare that to being aware and feeling at all times, no matter what's happening, everything is abiding in infinite spaciousness, effortlessly. And nothing that's happening is changing that fact in the slightest, but everything has this one shared quality, is exactly the same quality. Obviously, two very different feelings. So there does remain this one last little sticking point, but just let it stay there. Let it stay there for now. Like, well, why does it feel better? Why does it feel better? Or, you know, something like that. So let us just leave that for this moment. Let's not try to answer every single last question here. Let's simply, again, keep building this foundation of understanding and familiarity. This is part of the discipline, part of that we have here, is understanding our continuity problem. Don't try to force all the answers right at one moment. Leave a little bit unexplained here. Leave a little bit. And don't panic or insist, oh, I've got to have more. No, just say, that's okay. I know that that will be explained, and I'll be willing to listen to it once I get this foundation really strong here, really strong. And it's getting stronger and stronger every single day here. We're seeing the differences now. We're contrasting. What's the world? I call it the cult, the world cult, the goddess cult. I call it the goddess cult because it has to do with trying to make things beautiful, okay? And saying you should be happy with this is what's going to make you happy. Indulge in the senses as much as possible with things, okay? Be very spiritually materialistic, as it were. We're aware, okay, that's what that's about. And then we're saying this here is about something entirely different, right? And say, wow, there's a huge, huge difference there. It's very different than saying I'm one with everybody. Like, my persona, body space, is one with your body space, is one with that body space, is one with that body space. And in other words, we have a friendly relationship between body spaces. That's not it at all. It's not it. That's not remotely what we're talking about. So the language of the future is all full of language of oneness, togetherness, all this stuff. Spiritual language is being used. Enormous amount of spiritual rhetoric is being used. But the key essentials are completely missing. Severe continuity problem. Shifting the attention to infinite space around everything. All right. That resolves the continuity problem, actually. Because we don't want to put light on it. We don't want to make a definite determination about the light yet. Now, theoretically, we know everything's fine, but we're not ready for that. So this is this wonderful intermediate step. So the discipline right now is to leave this one little step untaken right at this point, right now. Just say, okay. It's like there's one more step to take across the river, a stepping stone. Just say, it's fine. You see the bank is right there. Say, I'm just one step I can make the bank. Don't take the step yet. Don't take it yet. Just get very comfortable where you are, in just seeing the landscape. Say, ah, okay, I'm understanding. There's a huge difference. Understanding what's being talked about here. I have a severe continuity problem. I don't want to put light on the spot. I don't want to make a complete, I don't want to make a definitive, final declaration of the light. Finding on the light, you know, which is it? I don't want to be completely definitive right this instant, totally once and for all. So I need this intermediate step. Keep it all objects, sensory perception still functioning fine, body's functioning fine, just a shift of attention and acceptance of what actually is already the case with pure the spaciousness that's everywhere. It's infinitely, everything is infinitely surrounded in all directions with this infinite spaciousness. I'm just going to do that. And anyone who comes and tells me that they have some super incredible spiritual teaching and other, and I lose sight of the fact that there's this infinite spaciousness surrounding them too, and all objects in the room, wherever I am, and me and everything, say, no, I'm not going to lose sight of that. I'm going to continue to see that, no matter what. And if they tell you, hey, I have a way to make this final determination for, you know, we're going to do it right now, forget it. We need the intermediate steps. I have a severe continuity problem. No, thank you. Seeing this infinite spaciousness around everything is for sure the safe way, the right way, the way that is going to resolve the continuity problem entirely. And we know that's going to be a good thing for us, right? That's a fail-safe way. Day-to-day, 96, cooling off a little bit now, not much. Now, it's highly possible, and actually, I'm thinking about this for the first time, and I'm just saying, wow, it's very likely that in my case, I lost a sense of infinite spaciousness, because I got pulled into studying spiritual teachers and teachings, and people were saying, this is so fantastic, you got to read this, you got to pay attention to this, and I forgot about the infinite spaciousness that's present, already present right now. I lost sight of it, so to speak. My attention got off of it because I was thinking that, oh, you gotta pay attention to this teacher, he's so wonderful, or she's so wonderful. Amazing. And then I thought that their teaching is the way. How do I get back? Oh, I have to listen to this teaching. That's how I lost it. That's how I got my attention in the wrong place, actually. It's all complex, all these complex teachings. Lately, I've been trying to read teachings, and I just immediately say, ah, no. Jump back from them. No, That's not it. Forget it. Forget it. Even Nisargadatta, I've been reading lately. Nisargadatta. Oh, by the way, this is by Jitendra Arya. This photograph, Jitendra Arya. Copyrighted, but with attribution is fine. It's a famous Indian photographer, Jitendra Arya. But Nisargadatta says the inner guru is the way. Listen to the inner guru. That's the advice I got. Boom. Now, it's amazing that people will hold up these great teachers like Nisargadatta and say, hey, listen to this, listen to this. And they're really saying, get in your personal space here. Here's a personal space. That's right. You know, you can actually be completely deluded doing that. In fact, that's very common. Very common. That may be why Ramana Maharshi taught in silence. There wasn't a sense of getting into any personal space there, was there? People might take you to a teacher, hey, you gotta come and see this teacher. This teacher's really popular, this is great. And you're so fixated on the teacher and the experience and everything there that you end up limiting yourself. You get this more of a sense of, okay, personal space, this building's important, this person right here is super important, this space is important, that kind of thing. One moment, please. Okay, now this inner teacher has told me, don't push too hard, leave just this one little area. Okay, fine. Leave just this one little area. It's funny that when we think about this infinite space, we think, but I'm going to lose the sense of this teacher. I'm going to lose the sense of... But the sense we had of that teacher was some kind of personal space, wasn't it? It wasn't really infinite space for everything. It was probably like a big space for this teacher. That's not it. That's a cult, actually. That's a cult. We find somebody that seems to have a big space. Like that, right? No. No, that's not what we're after. So again, the inner guru said, don't do it stepping stone wise, and don't try to do it too fast here. I say, come on, I got a deadline, which I do. He said, even so. But there's only one stepping stone left, even so. Stay where you are right now, just stay with this. And just find out, does it ring true? Does it ring true? Does the world fall apart? No. Very close to this other bank, the bank of infinite spaciousness, and we've been crossing the stream from the bank, the land of personal spaciousness, to the land of infinite spaciousness. It's like that. It's a river, one bank is. We've been crossing this river step by step on stepping stones. There's one stepping stone left. So the spiritual practice at this point is to see that there's just one stepping stone left. And to simply focus on that fact. Don't try to take the step yet. In fact, don't take it. That's what the inner guru told me. Don't take the last step. I said, what, are you crazy? I gotta take it. He said, no. Not yet. I said, wow, that's a tough one. First, get used to the astonishing breakthrough that just has happened. And that we've been able to see the whole picture, the whole context is right there. Wow. It's so simple. Be aware, the inner guru, inner Holy Spirit exists. The Holy Spirit's real. This information is giving is accurate. That's another, you know, tremendous, amazing realization. And it's kind of like you catch your breath. And what happens, what I'm experiencing, doing this live here, is a sense of desperation calms down. And which is important. You don't want to take that last step in a step of desperation. Because it will feel as though the situation is too much for us. We want to be calm. Not desperate, calm, poised and calm. There's still urgency, but not desperation. So the times of sitting quietly like this, very important. This is where the real work is done. Gathering your nerves. Not backtracking one step. and then realizing it's no longer complicated, is it? All the complications, if there's just one simple step left, actually. No complications. So you just say, wow, it's right here. I can do it. I can actually do this. See, all this stuff needs to settle in. I can actually do this. This I can do. This I can do. One moment. Okay, law of action. This I can do. This I can do. This I can do. This I can do. Just a simple awareness is all. Simple shift. Simple acceptance. This I can do. I can do that. It's not too much to do. It's not some, you know, sophisticated Sanskrit formula of all these gunas and sattva and da-da-da-da-da-da. Now this is just a completely simple. I can accept that if there's everything really is in infinite spaciousness, isn't it? Yeah, that's not a problem. I don't have to attach fancy words to that. It's the same for all, so why you need to talk, you know, define all these fancy definitions? No. Fancy explanations? No fancy explanations necessary. Therefore, easy to keep, easy to stay there, right? Easy to stay there. So there's all the settling down that needs to take place here. Factors, so many wow factors are present. Wow, I thought this would elude me forever. Wow, it didn't elude me. Wow, I thought I'd never get it. Wow, I've got it. Except for that just one little step, but I know that's easy, no problem. See, we have to see that this final step is easy by allowing all this continuity fear to die and to settle down. Otherwise, as we start to take the step, suddenly we'll panic. And we'll project all of this inner turmoil or unsettledness onto that step. We'll think, whoa, the step's it's unsettled. Wait a minute. Can't have that. The last step has to be firm. Last step has to be firm. There's a lot of people on the bank of personal spaciousness maybe laughing at us and saying, oh, isn't that an idiot? There's just one more step to take and they're not taking it. That's crazy. Of course, they're still on the bank of personal spaciousness, haven't taken any of the steps yet. Or there may be some who've taken some steps and they're looking and say, why, what's the matter with that? Why, how come they're not taking the last step? I guess crazy. Oh, there may be some theorists who say, yeah, just the oneness, of course, it's easy, just go, they haven't done it themselves. But they could say, well, it should be easy. I see the stepping stones, or I see the other banks right over there. What's the big deal? Should be easy. Yeah, but when you get to that next to last, you see there's one more stepping stone. Or you might even say there's simply the last step is right onto the other bank. You know, either way, maybe there's just one more stepping stone, actually. It's fine. You have to be there to truly appreciate the situation. Don't listen to all those others at this point. Because they don't understand the depth of the continuity fear. The continuity fear kicks up more and more the closer you get to the other bank. So they may start out, seems easy, you know, on a spiritual path, and how come more and more and more they go along, and they start realizing, wow, I'm getting closer and closer to that other bank. What's on the other bank? What, all the continuity fear starts kicking up, and they, you know, freeze up and say, whoa, wait a minute, I can't go any further. Things start to slow down. And the ones who haven't even started, they're not acknowledging the continuity fear at all. So they say, well, that's a big deal. I could do that anytime I want to. I'm happy here anyway, so why worry? If I want to, I can just go to the other bank, piece of cake. But actually, I feel happy right where I am. Or I think I can be happy where I am, so I don't even need to think about it. What's the big deal? I'll just make my personal space really great. Don't think that the Holy Spirit, the inner guru, is going to leave you just because you don't ask it for the, okay, let's make the next step, final step. No, it's the one that said, hey, don't worry, I'm with you. Just take it easy, just settle right where you are. Just gather your nerve, gather your poise, gather resolve, right there. It's not going to abandon you just because you don't, you know, immediately leap. You don't want to take a frantic leap. You want to just step calmly onto the other bank, with calmly, like, I'm home. This is where I belong. I feel comfortable taking that next step. Easy. This is going to be familiar territory for me, and this is where I want to be. So you take a nice, firm, smooth step, and just walk right onto the other bank. Just like that. No big deal. And the crossing is, you know, no longer an issue. Crossing the river is no longer an issue. So, yeah, I'm feeling all sorts of continuity fear. Jitters, from all sorts of angles, are reverberating around. Shaking, trembling. I read a quote from somebody. I was relating to the Bible, saying how God doesn't reject you just because when you take that final step, you're shaking and trembling and got the jitters. God's not going to reject you because of that. I said that's a good quote or commentary. Yeah, but we want these jitters to settle down. It's okay to have the jitters and let them and take a pause and let it all calm down. And there is. I seem calm on the outside. No, there's all sorts of trembling, kind of just subtle jitters and trembling going on. Very shaken up by recognizing the ever-present fact that we can do this so easily. You see, it's not something that we can't do. It's super easy. Recognizing how super easy it is does give us the jitters, because we say, wow, I might actually do it. I can actually do that. It's not the same thing as sitting in a cave doing breathing exercises for 30 years, is it? That's a lot. See, that's an expression of a lot of continuity fear, isn't it? Doing that way. It can work, anything way can work, but it takes a lot of poise to realize how actually completely easy and simple it is. We don't have to do anything except that slight shift to recognize it's already the case. I'd say the most important aspect of all these videos is the capacity, willingness to sit quietly as you have the jitters, as you make progress. Inevitably, when you make progress, you're going to get these jitters for sure. Making progress is difficult, but it's even more difficult to let the jitters die down. Let the dust settle. Let the dust settle. It's essential that one be able to do this. Not giving up, not saying I'm stopping here, no, I'm just pausing. I'm just pausing. I'm taking just a slight pause here. That's all. Sitting relatively still helps, because it sort of helps one feel the sense that there's one is stable. And that one doesn't have to take any actions. So one doesn't feel a lack of competence, and everything feels fine. Mind is calm. But there's like a tumultuousness within me, sort of a deep tumultuousness. This is just, you know, stunning. I really pressed for an answer today, so I have to know the answer. What is the answer? So I'm brought to this place to say, okay, and yet not leaping yet, just say, okay, just let it calm down. but is enabled by the discipline of being able to remain, to be calm and let the dust settle. Let the continuity fear settle down. And see, two go together, hand in hand, one moment. Okay, a lot of action here. Maybe that's why the Holy Spirit says, just take it easy. It's funny, this picture of Nisargadatta Maharaj is very different than all the other pictures. And this Jitendra Arya, who took this picture, is a very famous Indian photographer. He took pictures of celebrities, Bollywood celebrities and stuff. So he put Maharaj in this pose, you know. The other pictures of him don't look like this. It's very different. This gives a very different impression of what he looked like, actually. It's funny. It's a beautiful picture, for sure. but it's staged by an expert portrait, a celebrity portrait photographer. I didn't know that, but now I do. And so do you. It's important to not let the mind race. Don't let the mind race. Don't let the mind say, wait, that last step, what do I take? Okay, how do I figure this out? No, just stay calm, stay calm. Let the mind just be calm, simple. Not to try to think of anything. Be relaxed. I feel good tonight because the Giants are not playing. Off day. It means they can't lose. Can't lose. Can't lose today. Cannot. That's great. They were like the best team in baseball for the first 2 months, and suddenly the last month they're the worst team. How's that possible? Continuity fear, actually. They were doing so great, people started thinking they're a historically great team, the way they're winning. And for some reason, they freaked out. They freaked out. I said, whoa, we can't, this is too much, we can't handle this, right? So they turned into the worst team. Very funny. This just tells you, if you think you're going to be too successful, it can easily backfire on you. So it's very important when you're about to be extremely successful, there's no question that seeing infinite spaciousness around everything, excuse me, the root beer, is extremely successful. I mean, that's the ultimate, that is the goal here. That is the goal. Reach the goal. Reach the goal. Once you reach that goal, you're not going to be reborn here. Okay? That's how important it is. It's super important. So it's a big deal. It's a big deal. So, you kind of want to just don't let it get to your head. Just be conscious and be smart when you're on a winning streak. Just say, hey, okay, let's not think ahead too much here. Let's just, you know, stay steady. Let's catch our breath here. Of course, the fans of the Giants are like tearing their hair out. Wow, we thought you were going to win 110 games, you know. I thought you'd easy win the World Series. What's going on? You know, you got they're just going absolutely nuts. How is this possible? And just say, hey, don't worry. Just catch your breath. Catch your breath here. Stay poised. Stay completely poised. This is just a backlash. Continuity backlash. You maintain your absolute confidence. Simply continuity backlash. Don't read anything else into it. Fear of success. It's plain and simple. how long do you stay sitting? Stay sitting a long time. Just think about what the importance is, the consequences, huge. It's all important. It's like we're in a supreme crisis in this world, a supreme crisis in this world. There's no question about it. This is the crisis that we were warned about. We're in those times. Where we're warned that we're going to fall into delusion. We're going to fall in the darkness. Almost everybody. The temptation will be severe. Severe. And it certainly is. No question about it. It's unbelievable. So, we do, by all means, give it some time. Focused time, focused effort here. Do not get engrossed in projects. Try to avoid the getting engrossed in projects. Even reading books, that's a project too. Now, it's entirely possible that the shakiness, the trembling, the shakiness, the jitters may stay. But to a certain extent, but you know, it's like I'm just getting used to it. I'm getting used to it, and it's sort of a comfort zone, kind of getting comfort zone here. It's kind of like being able to walk during an earthquake. You know, if the earth keeps quaking, you'll figure out how to walk. It's very difficult to walk in a severe earthquake, actually. It's like the waves are going through the land, you know, and it's like, but you see, if you know that the jitters are within you, you won't think that the stepping stone is having the jitters, right? See, that's a problem. If you're not aware of what's going on within you, you project it outwardly and think that the ground might be shaking. Instead of I'm shaking, it's the ground that's shaking. Sometimes that happens when you get real tired or have low blood sugar. Somehow your body's like trembling or shaking. And if you're not aware, you think the ground is shaking. This happened to me a number of times. Think, oh my gosh, what's going on? It's an earthquake. And then I say, oh my gosh, no, it's my legs are all trembling. It's me. It's just a very different reaction, right? If you're not aware that it's you that's shaking, you think the ground is shaking. Then you'll think, oh my God, I gotta, you know, get panicking. So it's good to be aware that you are the one who is jittery, not the stepping stone. The stepping stone is totally secure. and we might underestimate the amount of jitters we have if we're not aware of just how incredibly important this is and what a monumental step it is, actually. If we just think, oh, it's no big deal, what's the big deal? The fact is, the continuity of fears will be, you'll be shaking and jittery and just like, and you know, your heart beating. And if you don't recognize it, I think it's no big deal. You think that the stone is all unstable and you'll jump back and say, hey, wait a minute, it's not a stable situation I'm going into here. And get all frightened and retreat back from it. You're aware of how absolutely profound and important this is, what a huge step it is, that the fact you have a severe continuity problem means you're very nervous and jittery. Deep down, you're like, wow, this is monumental. This is, you know, changes everything. It's a game changer. It is a total game changer. Then you realize, oh, of course I'm going to, it's me that is jittery, not the step, not the reasoning behind it, not the truth of it, not the stability of it. It's me that's just temporarily jittery. I'm not stepping onto an unstable bank, not going into an unstable land at all. It's total stability. It's me that's carrying this, you know, continuity reaction. And you don't project it, you don't misidentify it. And there's nothing, you know, profound going on. It's kind of like you shake up a bottle of water with some sediment in it. It gets all, you know, mixed, and you just let it all settle. Let it all settle with the water clear. You're just kind of waiting for the water to clear, kind of thing. Or at least as much as possible, letting it clear and just... You don't have to watch it, you know, intently necessarily. You don't have to, like, try to be super aware of all your sensations in your body or anything. No. Just sort of peripherally aware, a little bit. But not as a central focus. Not as a central focus at all. Just be aware, though, that there is a lot of nervousness going on. How about like pushing it, say, okay, I'm ready, let me go forward. Well, probably not. I feel like, yeah, maybe I could, but I think that the jitters are still strong enough that's not a wise idea. Better to wait until you have a real strong sense of resolve, determination. So in other words, catch your breath, let it settle down, catch your breath. And of course, humility wins the day. So you're saying, well, just one step away, but I'm going to just sit here quietly for a little bit here. I mean, I'm a bit frightened, of course. Continuity fear, of course. Anyone this close is bound to be frightened. Not overwhelmingly so, but jitters for sure, in many different ways. So, it's like the sword of disaster is hanging right over, you know, right over, ready to drop. And there's one more step to take. And yet still, we stay calm. We understand the urgency and the pressure. Yet still, we take a little break here. See, that's where the nerves come in. That's where the discipline comes in. Okay, very great. We'll see how it goes. Stay tuned. We'll see how it goes. All right, that's it.